Hi, everyone. It's great to be here with you today, talking about the Beethoven manuscripts here at the Morgan Library. I'm Robin McClellan, Assistant Curator of Music, and I'm really excited to show you two of the items we have of Beethoven's music here. Before I do that, I'd like to give you a quick overview of the materials that we have for Beethoven here. And a good way to get introduced to those is our Beethoven 250 exhibition, celebrating the 250th anniversary of Beethoven's birth. And we have a in-person exhibition, and then we converted it to an online exhibition as well, which you're welcome to peruse. And here's the link here, and you'll find it easily on our website as well. And I wanted to give a quick orientation that when you're in the exhibition, when you click on one of the images, it takes you to a screen where you can zoom in, and then you click on the little letter I at the lower right, and that takes you to another link that lets you go to the complete manuscript in our Music Manuscripts Online repository of digitized images, which is our entire collection, every page of every manuscript. You can also download the PDF, and that's a great way to dig in deeper if you're interested in learning more about any of these manuscripts. And it's a wonderful resource. So I just wanted to point that out. That's at themorgan.org/music. And right here you have, for example, our very first acquisition that Mr. Morgan himself made in 1907, the Beethoven Sonata Opus 96, which is a wonderful work. Today I'm going to be talking about two of the items, the Hammerklavier Piano Sonata Sketch Leaf, and then later I'll get to the autograph manuscript for the Ghost Trio, Opus 70, number 1. And in both cases, I'm going to delve in and analyze these works and talk about the musical material, but also a little bit about what they mean in a kind of larger sense. So here we have a sketch leaf of Beethoven from the Hammerklavier Piano Sonata, Opus 106, written in 1818. And it's just a single leaf front and back, and it's in our Mary Flagler Carey music collection. This is a major work from Beethoven's late period, heading into the last 10 years or so of his life. And it's a huge work. He was pretty much completely deaf by this point and actually intended to write a symphony, but instead wrote a piano work of symphonic scope. And there's actually an especially large number of sketches of this type for this particular work. So a little word about Beethoven's sketches in general. He wrote a voluminous number of sketches that were kept in these sketchbooks that he had either out on his walks or as he sat at his desk. And unlike other composers like Brahms, for example, who meticulously destroyed anything that he didn't want posterity to see, Beethoven actually kept these carefully, and they piled up in his home. And then after his death, they were eventually scattered far and wide and now exist in various libraries and archives around the world. In many cases, as here, just a single leaf from a sketchbook. And these have been, as we'll talk about, the source of a lot of scholarship and interest over the couple of centuries since Beethoven's death. So when I encounter a work like this, or an item like this, I have this immediate urge to kind of just jump right in and understand what's going on in the music. And I'm a musician, and some might assume that I can sort of just look at it and instantly know what's happening. That's maybe true for some people, but for me, it requires some study and care to understand what's going on. And so what I did here is I thought I'll make a quick transcription and hear what it actually sounds like. And so here we have, and a quick note that you don't need to read music to understand this presentation. I will always have audio samples and we'll kind of point through the music as we go along. So here what you'll see is I've transcribed the second line of music, which kind of runs off the right into the right margin in two little pieces. And I'll just point through just so you can hear what the music sounds like essentially. So here we go. That's one little bit, and when you're doing this, there's a lot of information that actually is left out. For example, he doesn't have clefs. but you can deduce those from the three flats in a key signature. Very often, certain accidentals are omitted. A big one is the tempo. The tempo that you just heard, the speed of the music, is really purely conjectural on my part. So there's a lot of kind of partly looking at what's there and partly filling in the gaps. Here's the second little bit. Have it. And now the nice thing would be to, if you know the final version of this work, would be to look at these and say, oh, here's, that part corresponds to this part in the final score. Maybe it's a little different. This is the sketch for that portion. Unfortunately, it's not nearly so simple. And in this case, there really is no obvious match to the published score of these two excerpts. So, they may be portions that Beethoven considered and then discarded or whatnot. We're going to come back to this later, and we're going to propose a possible connection to a portion of the score that's a little less direct. If this doesn't work out for us, this side of the page, there's of course more music on this page. We can flip it over. Recto is the fancy word for front, and flip it over to the verso or back. And here we have a helpful indication from Beethoven of the, he writes in fugue. And this gives us some hope, because there's a famous fugue in the Hammerklavier Piano Sonata, not in the slow movement, but in the final movement. So we might say, oh great, this is his sketch for that famous fugue. Again, we're out of luck because it turns out this is a fugue that never made it into any of his final works. But again, we can hear it really just for fun to kind of again get that intimate sense of what this sketch is trying to tell us, or really what it was trying to tell its creator, because these were, of course, really notes to himself. They weren't really intended for anyone else to try to decipher. And here we have just this little snippet of a fugue theme, which, of course, could be turned into a more fully worked out piece of music. So it's really very fragmentary, very sketchy, literally. But it's fun to kind of hear what Beethoven was thinking about. Now, we've seen that there's really isn't a direct correspondence always between a sketch and the final version. It gets much worse than that. Now, you don't have to understand everything on this page, on this screen that you're seeing. This is really kind of meant to give you a sense of how intimidating it can be to try to understand what's going on in these sketchbooks. For one thing, it can require in examining the physical evidence. For example, we have here for another work in our collection, the Piano Concerto No. 5. This is from the Grasnick sketchbook. These sketchbooks often have names. And we happen to have two separate leaves or pages from that sketchbook in two separate collections, the Heinemann collection and then the Mary Flagler Carey collection. But there are many other pages from this sketchbook in other archives and libraries. And so you see here, scholarly article, a scholar attempting to reconstruct this sketchbook and what the structure and the pagination might have been. Here we have a kind of chart showing the different pages. Leaf E is the one proposed, one of these here in New York Pierpont Morgan Library. Here we have some of the kind of machinations being done to figure out what's going on. Could the New York leaf be C? It appears to be the right quadrant and mold, but such other evidence as there is points in another direction, and so on and so forth. It's really quite a task to make sense of all of these. And then you have to look at the documentary and biographical evidence to figure out, did he refer to this sketch in a letter? Maybe that helps us identify when and what it was, and so on and so forth. It's not for the faint-hearted. Getting back to our Hammerklavier sketch leaf here at the Morgan, we do know a bit of the story, and you may have noticed something, that the lower left portion of the leaf has been cut out. Now, this happened a long time ago. Don't fear. And we happen to know a little bit about how this happened. The other thing you may notice is that on the right margin, it says in English, which you might not expect, Beethoven being German. It says, the handwriting of Beethoven given to me at Vienna, July 27, 1829 by Mrs. Streicher. Now the story here is that this leaf, this piece of Beethoven sketches was owned by Vincent Novello, who was the founder of a publishing company in Britain, which is still very vibrant. And he was one evening visiting Mrs. Nanette Streicher, who was a very old friend of Beethoven. They were playing music and enjoying the company. And Mr. Novello, in his writings later, recalled this incident and says, I had some of Beethoven's own handwriting on the table before me, from which Mrs. Streicher was so kind as to say I could choose whatever I thought proper. I selected two, and I shall surely preserve them with the greatest veneration. Now, his definition of the greatest veneration might differ a bit from ours in that we probably would not take scissors to any of Beethoven's venerated manuscripts. What he did with it was he took that piece and put it in an autograph album along with snippets of manuscripts of other composers he admired, Mozart, Haydn, and so on. And that was his way of venerating this work. And over the years, the two pieces went their separate ways, and the larger piece ended up here at the Morgan Library in New York. And I actually don't know the current location of the other piece, but I was able to find a facsimile of it in a scholarly article. And here on your very screen, they are finally reunited. And you can see a couple of things in the way that they relate. The fit is about right. They both say the handwriting of Beethoven in Mr. Novello's handwriting. And then even this low staff of five-line staff is divided into three and two lines. And we're going to come back to that and look a little bit more at the piece that is missing. But before that, I want to delve a little into that word that Mr. Novello used, veneration. Let's talk about what that means. And while it may have meant something different to Mr. Novello, it's really very much still with us, and it's part of the reason that we're here today talking about these manuscripts. Before we delve into that, I want to set the stage a little bit by playing you a portion of the slow movement from the Hammerklavier Piano Sonata. This is with Daniel Barenboim. And as you listen, I just want you to notice a few things. Take note of the church-like atmosphere in the concert hall, the rapt audience sitting in silence, and then this heroic figure on stage in the spotlight, in this state of deep concentration, almost as if he's channeling something from the great beyond. And keep that word veneration in mind as you listen. We'll just play a brief excerpt. It there and move on. It's hard to cut it off, but it's a 20-minute movement out of 45-minute work. So I would encourage you to listen to it. So what I'd like to do is to not take that idea of veneration for granted. I want to call out explicitly what these manuscripts can mean to us and how they can serve as a form of musical scripture and what that phrase really means. So you may have done some study or be familiar with the Romantic movement in Western culture. And I want to call out two ideas that are really at the core of that movement. One was expressed by Jean-Jacques Rousseau in his Confessions, and one of the early autobiographies. Was really not something that was common before that, to simply sit down and write the story of one's life. And in his introduction, where he's kind of explaining this novel concept, he writes, "Even as thou hast read my inmost soul." And he's talking about the inner subjectivity that each of us has, that, as he proposes, is unique to each person, and that we can express to others and share kind of our true selves with others. And this may be a very familiar idea to you, because I think it's a really core and common part of our current cultural dialogue with each other. But at the time, it was a fairly new idea, at least to do it in this kind of public way. That's one piece of the Romantic movement that's important here. Another was expressed really best, or very well, by Beethoven himself in this touching letter that he wrote in 1802 as he was beginning to realize that he was becoming deaf. And he went out to a house in the country at Heiligenstadt by himself, and was in a really desperate state of sorrow and worry, because as a musician, going deaf is really one of the worst things that could really happen to you. And he writes in this impassioned way. He says, "It was impossible for me to say, 'Speak louder, shout, for I am deaf.' How could I possibly admit such an infirmity in the one sense which I once possessed in a perfection you enjoy?" And this is the key part. He says, "My misfortune must lead to my being misunderstood. I must live like an exile." And he directly channels that idea that I think is also very familiar to us as the artist, as an outcast, as a kind of misunderstood outsider who struggles alone in creating their art. Now, he never sent this letter, and it was discovered after his death, and he, though he considered suicide, of course, he lived many more years. But I think one thing that's fascinating about this letter is thinking of that inner subjective self. What could drive one more deeply into that inner self than deafness, where it cuts you off from others and you become, of course, not, it doesn't have to, but it certainly, compared to the average person, it isolates a person. And so Beethoven became a kind of exemplar of that idea of going deeply into that inner personhood that each of us has. It took E.T.A. Hoffmann, a writer of the time, to kind of put all this together and create kind of the theory of Beethoven. He was an influential writer and composer himself, and wrote an essay in 1813 called Beethoven's Instrumental Music, where he kind of laid out this theory of what Beethoven's music meant. And he writes, speaking of Beethoven, "Music discloses to man an unknown realm, a world that has nothing in common with the external sensual world, a world in which he leaves behind all definite feelings. Music," and Hoffmann is speaking specifically of instrumental music, "is, quote, the most romantic of all the arts, for its sole subject is the infinite." I want to unpack that statement a little bit. It's in this flowery early 19th century language. He's talking about that idea of the inmost soul, not just being something that's unique to each of us, but being an access point where each of us can reach and into this kind of infinite realm of the spirit, the spiritual realm. And he's setting up music as an art form that uniquely allows us to do that, as compared with the other arts, because it's not representational. It doesn't depict things in the world. When you write a poem, it's usually, at this time at least, it was a poem about something. If you paint a picture, it's a picture of something. Whereas music is really this abstract language, which is the pure language of the soul. This is the idea. And therefore, instrumental music is the highest art form. He even says music with words, opera and so on, is a little bit tainted by its representational form. Now, you may object that Beethoven himself wrote things like the Pastoral Symphony, which was depicting the countryside. And it was programmatic music, where music is trying to tell an explicit story that is representational. There are subject headings in the symphony, like a babbling brook or strolling over the green hills. But what Hoffmann or Beethoven might have argued is that they were not, but the music is not trying to actually depict those green hills. It's trying to evoke the feeling in your soul that you would get walking through those green hills. And so it's still referring to that inward self. Hoffmann then takes it to the next level. He says in another place, writing of Beethoven, his kingdom is not of this world. And so he really sets up a deliberately religious framework where in that, for that infinite realm of the spirit, as in his phrase, we kind of put that's in the place of God. And then in the place of a prophet, or explicitly evoking a Christ-like figure with his phrase, his kingdom is not of this world. We think of someone who sees further and more clearly than the rest of us. And in that place is placed Beethoven. You can think of that if you know the Allegretto from the Symphony Number 7. This is another item in our collection, in the James Fold collection. I don't have an audio sample, but just very briefly, you may remember this kind of insistent rhythm that continues throughout the movement. Da, dun, dun, da, 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 da. And it just has this rising, slowly building energy that I think has that kind of prophetic quality that Beethoven became known for. And so in this way, we can say that the score becomes a form of scripture, the musical score. Before, really, it was just a means to an end. It was like a blueprint to a house, in this phrase I like of Carl Dalhaus, a musicologist. It was a mere recipe for performance. And you can see that in the way that, for example, Mozart treated a score, where he would often, for a piano concerto, he would, if he was in a rush, he wouldn't bother writing out the left hand because he knew it by heart and he might want to change it a bit on the fly anyway. And improvisation was alive and well in this time. And so the score was important, but it wasn't the be-all and end-all. Similarly, with our story of Mrs. Stryker giving away the sketch leaf to Vincent Novello, you know, there was a veneration, but it was something you could give away casually at a dinner party. And compare all of that with now, the score has become this kind of inviolable document of this spiritual truth. And that might sound overstated, but I think it really captures something very true about the way that this these scores are understood. And the way you can think of it is that when it comes to something like Beethoven, you don't riff on the Bible, you don't mess with it. It's the really the word of the prophet, almost very literally. And we see that in the way that we treat these scores now. They're worth untold sums. They're hung on the walls of institutions like the Morgan Library. And that's really kind of, that was a big change that occurred around in Beethoven's lifetime and in the midst of the Romantic movement. This comes down to us in the present day, this attitude toward these scores, and you can see it in this series of lectures by Pierre Boulez, in this review by John Adams, just from last fall. John Adams is one of the preeminent composers living today, and Pierre Boulez is a major 20th century figure who died in the early 2000s, a conductor, composer, and writer about music. And he said, Boulez writes, anything not contained in the notes on the page, he dismisses. Sorry, this is Adams describing his Boulez's attitude. Anything not contained in the notes on the page, he dismisses. Performance tradition, anecdotal history, biographical gloss, or even recordings. The text for Boulez is the notated score, the only, quote, true mentally reliable resource safe from any other form of dissemination. And there was more context to this. Boulez was an incredible conductor and was trying to preserve some of the clarity of the score, but it really speaks to that attitude which that we have toward these scores that was a sea change from what came before. So this allows us to extend the framework that E.T.A. Hoffmann had set up that I showed you before, with God in the place of this, the infinite realm of the spirit, Beethoven serving as the prophet, and then we have the role of the priest in this sort of religion, where I would place the performers, as we saw earlier, the scholar, the teacher, the curator, the composer working today, interpreting these works, kind of trying to make sense of them. We saw that scholarly article, trying to understand these musical scriptures. What are they trying to tell us? And then I think most important of all, the everyday faithful, all of us listening to this music, the magic happens in the mind of each person listening. And so really this framework kind of holds up, I think, although it's of course a bit of a conceit to make the comparison. I would say that I love this quote of Richard Taruskin, in that where he says, in displaying these scores, our role is not just curatorship, but at the highest level, ministry. And Richard Taruskin is a major musicologist working today. And I like this not because it sets up my role, for example, as a curator, as some glorious thing, but really highlights its humility. It's the importance of approaching these manuscripts with humbleness and trying to understand what's going on when we look at these. So with that idea of the scholar as interpreter of a musical scripture, I want to get back to our Hammerklavier Piano Sonata leaf. And earlier we reconstructed it with this facsimile and the image of the leaf that we have here at the Morgan. And it turns out, this is relying on the work of scholar Nicholas Marston, that there's really only one portion of this whole leaf, as far as we know, that's definitely related to the final score. And it's on the piece that we don't have here at the Morgan, this little bit outlined in red. And I can prove it to you with another transcription. So here I've written out the notes in Beethoven's sketch right here, and then here's the passage in the final score that corresponds. And both visually, I think, and then as you listen, I think you'll hear and see the relationship. It's really just this very little snippet. And here's the final version. Of a much longer passage, of course. So that's the part that corresponds to, that's the part of the sketch leaf that corresponds to the final score. I'd like to take a moment to bring in another perspective, that of the performer. And this is interesting to me because the ear is a different thing than the eye, and it notices different things. And I needed some help here. So a friend of mine is a wonderful pianist, Thomas Sauer, my former piano teacher. And I emailed him, this is the same transcription that I showed you near the beginning of the second line on the front of this sketch leaf. And I just emailed him this little bit and I said, is there any chance, and he knows this work intimately, he's played it hundreds of times, studied it deeply and knows it better than anyone. And so I thought, you know, is there anything that he might happen to notice here? And he emailed me back within a short time and said, now I can't prove this to a scholarly degree, but you know, this little bit here reminds me of the famous passage at measure 28. And this bit over here reminds me of the visionary moment at measure 152 into 53. And so when you look at it, the visual relationship is not clear. It's something that if you're looking at it purely from a kind of ability to prove the point as a scholar would do, you can't prove the point. There's no way to show that Beethoven definitely had a relationship here. But when you listen to it, I think you may hear what my friend was talking about. And I think this is a very important perspective in addition to the more kind of scientific approach of a scholar. And so I'll play again this little passage here and then the corresponding passage in the final score. And then this little bit starting here. And so again, you may or may not hear the relationship, but I think it's worth, if you're into this sort of thing, it's worth spending time with it. And for the second option, I'm going to make that a little treasure hunt. If you're interested in this, you can check out my transcription and then go and find measures 152 and 153 and see if you hear the relationship. But again, I think this perspective is just as important as that of the scholar. Now that ends our portion on the Hammerklavier Sonata. And now I'd like to move to a different kind of object in our collection, a complete autograph manuscript. Now this is no longer just one page, but now we're talking about the full record of the piece as Beethoven left it. And this is no longer just sketches, but the music as he intended us to hear it. And so it's much easier and to match the final score because this really is the music fully worked out. This is the piano trio, Opus 70, number one, called the Ghost Trio. And the reason for that is that some listeners have heard possible references to the ghost in Hamlet or to Macbeth in this music. None of them directly attributed to Beethoven, although he was working on a Macbeth project at the time. This is a middle period work, about 10 years earlier than the piano sonata we just looked at, about three movements, 25 minutes long, and it was written around the time of that pastoral sixth symphony that we were talking about. What I'd like to do is to play you just the beginning, and then we're going to focus on the end of this work because he writes not one but five possible endings. So again, it's no longer a sketch, it's the fully worked out music, but he's still working some things out, and there are a lot of things scratched out and a lot of revisions that we can trace his compositional process. And I'd like to approach this from a kind of composer's analytical perspective. I'm a composer myself, and I'll talk a little bit about my own perspective on this music and kind of things that I find familiar in the process of composing. So here we have the opening of the score. And I just want to play this one page because this motive, this triplet motive, which you'll hear, will come back in a very important way in the endings that we'll look at. And the triplet is these three little notes here that have this distinctive rhythm, da 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 da, and you'll hear that again and again, and it becomes a kind of a character in the story that this music is telling, this abstract spiritual story of this instrumental music. So I'll play just this page and then we'll delve a little deeper into this work. That's just a quick sample. Now what I'd like to do, very often in an exhibition, for example, you see just the one page of a manuscript or even in online settings. And so I'd like to take this chance to show you an entire movement of this work. It's three movements. This is the middle movement, which is the source of that ghost moniker because people feel that it sounds kind of ghostly, as you may have thought just listening just now. But what's fun about it is that you see the kind of feeling of the way that Beethoven writes and as he gets less and less sure of himself as he goes on through the movement. So this first page is quite clear, confidently written. He knows what he's doing. Page two, likewise, it's all very clear. Then we get to page three and we see a few scratch outs. So it's a little messier. But, you know, it's still, this is the record of the music as he intended. Page four is looking okay. Page five, likewise. And again, if you want to slow down and delve into this, all of this is on our Music Manuscripts Online page. You can download the PDF and peruse this at your leisure. Page 6, looking okay. 7, 8, around 9, there starts to be more scratch outs. 10, 11, page 12 is a bit of a mess. Page 13, and now page 14, we're sort of coming in for a landing. And what I'd like to do here is play you from this page to the ending. And you'll notice and you'll hear that triplet motive from the opening, which you will have heard throughout the movement. I encourage you to listen to the whole movement. You'll hear that in a couple of places, and then we'll talk more about it. At the end of the piece. Except, just kidding, because as if you know this work, you know that it continues. And this is one of my favorite things that happens in Beethoven a lot, where he does this. He gets you to a point where you feel like the piece is ending. And just at that moment when you're starting to relax, this long story has been told, something like this happens. I'm not going to give away the true ending because it took Beethoven a while to work it out, and I want to walk through that a little bit. Here we have the following page, page 15, and what I've done is marked the five different endings in a color-coded way. So in red, now again, you don't have to understand every detail of this. It's just to give you kind of the broad strokes. In red, we have the music as it ended up in the final version. In blue, we have the first attempt at an ending that Beethoven made, which, as you can see, he crossed out the entire thing. And you can see these little squiggles at the very end that indicate the final bar line. So he decided against that and tried two other little sketchy endings. You can see the squiggles again. And I want to take a moment to just talk about my perspective on endings of pieces. This is something, the struggle that he goes through here is something I can personally relate to as a composer. I find that endings are often the most difficult part of a piece to get right, and also the most important because it functions as kind of the moral of this story. You've been weaving this spell, hopefully, throughout the piece, telling a musical story, and if it doesn't kind of sum up just right at the end, the whole effect can be lost. And so I often struggle with endings, and I see here that Beethoven did as well. And there's a wonderful YouTube recording of Leonard Bernstein doing a very similar type of analysis that's the one I'm doing here. Of course, he's Leonard Bernstein. He's amazing, and he analyzes the Fifth Symphony. And what's fascinating is that in that case as well, Beethoven chose from multiple endings as well, and you'll see that he did something similar. And so, moving on to the next page, we've discarded ending A, we've discarded these other two possibilities. The music goes on in its what became its final form in red, a few more measures. Then we get into what I've called ending B, his second kind of main attempt. Onto the final page, again, ending B is crossed out. And finally, we have the ending as it was eventually published. What I've done to this, just to scroll back through here, this is a mess. It's hard to sort of make sense of. So what I've done is I have made three transcriptions of those three main endings. So you can hear what Beethoven was trying to do. And this is what I called ending A that was outlined in blue. And here's a little audio sample here. It's starting at that point that we thought it was ending. And so if you know the piece well, this will be interesting to see this ending that you've probably never heard unless you've done this very study. And it's a fairly conventional ending. It's that, you know, again, he gets you to the point where you think it's gonna end, and then he spins this kind of final little spell at the very end, but then he ends on a very conventional cadence, and there's some moving lines in the middle, which he took out, which refer back to other parts of the piece. Let's look at the next attempt. This is why I pointed out that triplet motive earlier, because now he decides to bring that back. It's an important character in the story, so to speak, and let's see what it sounds like with that sort of right at the very end. So there's this kind of outburst at the end, and it has a very different effect than that much more mellow ending that we heard first. So, you know, he tries the mellow ending, he tries the outburst. Evidently, neither one was satisfactory, and so we get to the one that he finally chose. You'll notice right away that it's two measures shorter, just to jump back, instead of 98 measures, 96. And then again, to make the comparison, at this point where it's this rising line in the violin, it gets to this G minor chord right here on measure 95. In the final version, rather than continuing through that sort of lyrical line, he cuts it off short, right at that B flat. And then this is again measure 95, and then this curt little eighth note, and then these very quick little 16th staccato notes. And so I don't know his reasons, of course, we can't get into the mind of Beethoven, but speaking purely subjectively as a composer, as a listener, as all of us are, I don't have any special status as a composer other than having tried this a lot myself, but I can say that it makes sense to me why he chose this one. I think it's a little bit more interesting, a little bit more unexpected, and it really follows the principle of less is more. I think that if you can say it in less time, it's almost always better. And there's something chilling, I think, about the curtness and the briefness of this ending. And it's interesting too, I referred to the Leonard Bernstein analysis of the Fifth Symphony. In that case as well, Beethoven chose the shorter of the endings that he considered. So I think it's a fun view into the creative process that he was undertaking. And with that, I'd like to end with a brief playing of the ending of the piece with the real musicians. Just so you can we can give Beethoven the final word, and so you can hear the ending that he intended in its final version. Jumping back a little bit. And there you have it. So with that, I'd like to close and thank you again for being here. I hope it's interesting to delve into some of these manuscripts in more depth. And of course, a similar study in much more depth could be done with any one of the many manuscripts we have here at the Morgan. And here's a few quick references for you. If you want to view the Beethoven 250 exhibition online, here's the link. This is the Morgan Music Manuscripts Online, which again contains our whole repository of digitized images. You can download PDFs, you can explore at your leisure. I encourage you to do that. This is that Leonard Bernstein lecture that I mentioned. And then if you really want to devote the rest of your life to the study of the sketchbooks, there is a book that you can read. It's really the book on the sketchbooks, and here's that information. And of course, there's a lot more resources. So again, thank you for being here. I'm Robin McClellan, Assistant Curator of Music at the Morgan Library, and I'm so glad you shared this time with me. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.